Lending Solutions, HousingWire, the Apartment Owners Association, the San Diego Creative Real Estate Investors Association, InvestClub for Women, MVT Productions, Property Radar, the San Jose Real Estate Investors Association, and White House Catering.
Good evening, everybody. Could I ask you to all stand for the Pledge of Allegiance? It works every time. Ready? Begin. I pledge allegiance. Thank you. So, welcome to I Survived Real Estate 2015. Thank you. Please continue to enjoy the meal. We got to get going because we have two shows going on. There's one right here, right now, and there's one going on online. So, we are going to continue with the party. So, this is I Survived Real Estate 2015. It is our eighth year. 8 years ago, when we first started, we had, thank you. 8 years ago, we had no idea we'd be looking at so many friendly, familiar faces around the room. I often get thank you notes from your significant others saying that it's the only time you ever get dressed up. So apparently this event has many benefits. In all seriousness, I just wanted to say thank you. Many of you over the years have been very supportive of our family. One of the only reasons I ever moved back to California, if you would have asked me 12 years ago if I would have ever moved back to California, I would have said, no way, Jose. I lived in New York City. My mom found out that we have New Yorkers in the house tonight. My mom found out she had bone cancer, and it was the only reason that I came back out, and it was one of the best decisions I ever made. Thank you. You all have been a great support. She passed in 2011, and you have all shared all of your stories and the struggles, and it's become a tradition, and it's a big part of this event. If you, your inner circle, family member, whoever it is, if they've been have been or are currently struggling with cancer, will you please stand? It's always a very large number. Thank you so much. So, thank you. So it's one of the reasons we do this event is to raise awareness and a lot of money, and we've done that tonight. So, in the last 4 months, you around this room has helped us raise over $72,000 this year. Thank you. That brings the grand total in only 8 years. We are very close to hitting the $600,000 mark. So, for those of you who are online, tonight, it's up to you. We don't have that far to go. So if you're enjoying the program, you don't get off that easy. You might not be enjoying this fabulous meal and the awesome space. But you can always give. If you're at isurvivealestate.com and you're on the watch live, there is a link and you can give. And please do. We're really hoping to cross that $600,000 mark tonight. In the audience tonight, we've got two members who went above and beyond. Is Buddy Broom and Tom Hewock here tonight? I don't think I saw Tom. Buddy, there you are. There's a little bit of a competition every year, and they were $10 apart. You guys raised the most out of everyone. And they were part of an awesome team, InvestClub for Women, who raised over $6,500 this year. So thank you. Our efforts tonight benefit two incredibly important nonprofits. Both help children with life-threatening illnesses. Odette Gutierrez is going to come up and talk a little bit about St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital. And while she's coming up, we're going to show a short clip.
I really love playing football and lacrosse. I play that for my high school up in New York. I just really enjoy football. I have from like the beginning. It's like up there with like bacon and my mom. Those are like top three right there. It's like a second chance for me, honestly, to play.
It was about 5 o'clock in the morning. Something woke me up, and I went into his room, and he was kind of staring off into space with this fixed stare, but his little finger was kind of scratching at the side of the bed. So I went in and spoke to him, and he couldn't speak back, and I believed I was seeing a seizure.
And then she brought me into the hospital to get checked out and whatever, and that's how they discovered the tumor.
They came and told us that there was a mass on his brain, and they were only giving him about a 30% chance of survival. I was scared to death, but I couldn't let on that I was scared because I had to be strong for Jake. My sister found a research article at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. At the bottom of the article, it said, "For more information, call this number." Within an hour of making the call, Dr. Merchant called us back.
Jake was newly diagnosed with ependymoma. Jake had the most aggressive form called anaplastic ependymoma. Ependymoma typically arises in very young children, and those are the children that are most vulnerable to the side effects of treatment. So we pioneered the use of radiation therapy in children. We brought children to Memphis for this specialized treatment. And then what we did that was unique was to follow them very carefully afterwards to show the rest of the world that this treatment could be administered safely.
And at the time, he said they were getting about an 80% chance of survival. And so every day we would come to the hospital and he would receive his radiation treatment daily.
His tumor presented with seizures. And so that's why he came to see me, because I do EEGs, which are brainwave tests. And that was the first time I saw this cute, cuddly little boy.
We will take a run.
Jake and his mother, they were quite amazing from the beginning. And whenever Dr. Merchant would come in the room, he was just so excited to see him. He was quite a Dr. Merchant's little man.
I would exchange like a drawing with him or something I made. And the first thing I gave him was a birdhouse. And I guess he still has it. So that's just amazing to me. It just shows how much of a great guy he is.
It's a good-looking birdhouse, and it's well-designed. I've kept it all these years because it just makes me feel special and reminds me of him and his accomplishments.
The left side's like the blind side of the quarterback.
I learned that in the blind side.
Yeah.
Over time, he just got better and better.
I'm proud that he has grown so well and done so well in school.
To see him turn out as well as he did was really a dream and actually a goal of our initial study. Jake, now a 14-year survivor, proves that treatment not only works, but that it is safe.
To be a survivor, it's a great feeling because I still get to live. They gave me a life. St. Jude gave me a life to live. And you can never repay them for that, too.
He's not just survived, he's thrived because of the treatment that was established and given to him.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening. I had the pleasure of attending I Survive Real Estate last year, and I am thrilled to be here. On behalf of the doctors, the patients, I just want to say thank you so much to the Norris Group, to all of the generous sponsors who have made this event possible, and to all of you who support the life-saving work of St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. Thank you. While many of you may have heard about St. Jude, I hope to share with you tonight why St. Jude is leading the way the world understands, treats, and defeats childhood cancer and other deadly diseases. Located in Memphis, Tennessee, St. Jude treats some of the sickest children from Orange County, across the U.S., and around the world. And while St. Jude can only treat a fraction of the 175,000 children who are diagnosed with cancer each year, St. Jude is also making a difference in the global fight against childhood cancer. One of the ways that St. Jude is doing this is by freely sharing the discoveries it makes so that every child saved at St. Jude means doctors and scientists worldwide can use that knowledge to save thousands more children. Some of the best researchers and doctors come to St. Jude to be part of the fight against pediatric cancer because thanks to donors like you, they have the freedom to focus and to do whatever it takes to save the life of every child who becomes a St. Jude patient. Remarkably, treatments invented at St. Jude have helped push the overall cancer survival rate from 20% to more than 80% since the hospital first opened more than 50 years ago. Additionally, what makes St. Jude such a unique place is that families never receive a bill from St. Jude for treatment, travel, housing, or food, because all a family should worry about is helping their child live. And as Jake's mom, expressed in the video, St. Jude not only allows for some patients to simply survive, but to thrive in their lives. That is the hope we have for every child and the reason why your continued support is so important. Thank you so much.
Okay, next we're going to get Kel Lindstedt up here with Make-A-Wish, and we're going to watch a short little clip about Make-A-Wish.
Tonight we are going to open Amina's Cafe, and Amina is a six-year-old, lovely, vibrant little girl who wants to be a chef. So tonight we are here at the Thermidor Event and Design Center to do just that.
We were honored to partner with Make-A-Wish Orange County and Inland Empire to grant Amina's wish. Amina's a lovely, very special girl, and her dream is to become a chef. And what better place to become a chef than in our Thermidor Pro kitchen?
First, I put avocado and a little bit, and then I sided it. And then what I did is I put the shrimp, and then I put a little bit of some vinaigrette, and then I put tomato on top.
Amina was diagnosed with leukemia ALL. She was diagnosed March 12 of 2012. And when she found out about the Make-A-Wish, she was so excited that her dream was gonna come true of cooking for us. She always likes to cook for us.
I love to cook because I like cooking and because I used to cook with my daddy in the night and I really liked it. I'm just so happy that they did this.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm actually really excited about tonight because I've heard so many great things about what the Norris Group does at this event, and I'm hoping I won't be disappointed. I'm actually planning to stick it out and learn some things from you guys. It's kind of hard to follow a wish video like that, and I have sort of the unenviable position of following two videos, which puts me a little off balance in a sense, because I don't think that there's much that I can add to the wish experience that Amina here didn't just say with her smile and with her own words. But what I'd like to do is try to put it in context just a little bit for you guys. I think that a lot of people recognize fairly easily, especially after you watch a video like Amina's, that the wish experience really has a huge impact on the wish child. But what sometimes gets left out and sort of lost in the mix is the way that the wish experience actually impacts so many other people that surround that child. Now, Amina's story actually started back in 2012 when she was first diagnosed with cancer. And as a child, I really can't imagine what that's like to live through. And it's a little bit ironic, Aaron, because before I came here tonight, when I was writing the speech, I actually had no idea that you were going to call everybody out on the cancer angle. I was actually going to mention that my mother's actually at City of Hope right now as I speak, being treated for lymphoma that she's been fighting for about 3 years. So I do know what cancer looks like in a sense. I've seen that firsthand, that struggle, and how difficult that is. But I also have two little kids, and as a father, I really, like I said, I can't imagine what it would be like to have a child in Amina's position that has to go through that. And so I think that exactly is why Make-A-Wish exists. That's why the organization was founded, to help these children that are going through this kind of a thing that adults struggle with, my mother's struggling with, and that so many people in this room have seen firsthand. And that's why we founded the organization and why we do what we do. And the interesting part about it is the way that Amina's wish has touched so many other people. And I actually brought with me today, I have a little souvenir, if you will. You saw her signing her cookbook there at the end of the video, and I've actually got one of those. It's an original, authentic, autographed. it's actually, you know, her little purple handwriting on the back. And I have this, I keep this pinned on my wall in my office. I have a little cork board, and I pin it up there whenever I'm having sort of a rough day or I can't remember why I took this job, which doesn't happen very often. I look up at that, and it's one of the mementos that we have from some of our Wish kids. It really helps me remember sort of why we all get up and do this every morning. And it's something that you all have become a part of by joining this I Survived Real Estate program. All of your fees that you guys paid to be at this wonderful event go to St. Jude and to Make-A-Wish. And so you guys have really stepped up. And you're not just here to learn something about how to make some money from real estate this year, which I hope you do. Hopefully, Aaron, right? But you guys are really extending yourselves into the philanthropic space and really making a difference rather than just building your careers. And I think those things go really well hand in hand together. So I really want to thank you all for coming out and for participating in this fantastic program and for supporting the charities that you guys do. I actually have one other souvenir, if you will. This one's for Aaron. I have here a plaque, and Aaron, I want to give this to you on behalf of, let's turn around so folks can see it. I think everybody had a chance to see it as we were coming in. This Adopt-A-Wish plaque, Aaron, commemorates the work that you guys have done to adopt Anthony's wish. Anthony actually wished to meet the 49ers, and so we hope that you will. I know, it wasn't my choice either. Actually not a huge sports fan, so I probably shouldn't say that with a microphone in my hand. But Aaron, we really can't thank you enough for putting this event together, for bringing all these wonderful people here. And I know you guys are here to hear about real estate, and we'll get to that in just a second. But I really can't stress enough that by coming out tonight and by doing something like this, you're not only, you know, advancing your professional careers, but you're also making a huge difference in your communities. And those ripples from that wish are coming through this room right now, and all of us get to experience that over again. So thanks for coming, and thanks for your support.
As always, I'm going to leave this up front because this is just as much yours as it is ours, so please take pictures with it, and I got to finally put these up on the wall. I've got a few of them now. It's really cool. So the cause, awesome causes. Thank you so much again. We really can't do it without all of you here. So on with the show. If you could please silence your cell phones. If you are one of those people who like the hard candy that's wrapped in the really loud stuff, don't be that person. Do it now. Get it over with. You know who you are. If you missed something tonight, please don't worry about it. We are videotaping it and audio taping it. It will end up on the radio show and podcast later, as well as on YouTube. And you may not know today is Bosses Day, National Bosses Day. So you can silence your cell phones, but maybe you want to send that last email so you can get it in so you don't get in trouble, for those of you with a boss. And I have one of the best bosses in the world. Last month, I got to celebrate my 10 years with the Norris Group, and it's been 10 wonderful years. Thank you. So tonight, he's the one who allows us to put on this great event. He's been a real estate investor for over 30 years, part of thousands of transactions as builder, hard money lender, real estate investor. He hosts our award-winning radio show, which morphed into this 8 years ago. I get to call him Dad, Bruce Norris.
Thank you. Happy Bosses Day.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Is there something that I have to turn on? Am I good? Okay. Thank you so much. It's always hard for me to watch those videos and not tear up and have my son do what he did. So thank you for coming. In 1980, I had a unique experience. I was in an audience of about this many people attending a seminar I didn't want to be at because I already thought I knew everything. And there was a gentleman named Jim Rohn who in 3 hours changed my entire life. His dedication to sharing what he could do for other people changed my life and allowed me to see a different way that life could turn out, provide for different things for my family, be proud of what I did, and then also got the bug to share. And so last year we decided that we would create an award in honoring Jim Rohn. We called it the Rohnie Award, and Jack Fullerton was the first recipient. And tonight we have a second recipient. Our recipient tonight had a rough start, and I'm very thankful that he shared this story with me. I've known him for a long time, and I didn't know he was an orphan. At 4 months, he was dropped off at an orphanage, and he lived there, he said, till he was 11. But at 8 years old, he had a very important week. His Aunt May came and picked him up for a trip, and she had a Packard, and his brother hogged the back seat, and it forced Ward Hannigan to sit in the front seat. And what happened during that week is that him and May connected somehow, and he just had the most delightful week. But there was one particular day where Aunt May looked at Ward and said, "Ward Hannigan, I'm not going to worry about you anymore. You're going to grow up to be a great and wealthy man." And Ward said that when he heard that, he never doubted it for a moment. It went to the bone marrow in him, and he faced a lot of tough things, but he always landed on what she had said, and he said, "Everything's going to be okay. Someday I'm going to be great." And I met Ward taking a class from him. He always teaches one-on-one, and that was my first experience with Ward. And I've known him now for several decades. I've never heard anything bad said about the man, ever. When my son Greg decided he was going to take training about buying trustee sales, I said, "Well, you got to take Ward's training." I said, "To be honest with you, I'd pay $5,000 to him just so you could pick the phone up to call him, because he's literally the hands-down expert in that field." And if you go to his website, I think there's some significant pieces to the puzzle that get beyond money and get beyond what he has. It's who he is. And there on the website, there's a purpose. And the purpose says, to win the hearts, minds, and smiles of real estate entrepreneurs everywhere by truly satisfying their quest to learn how to become financially independent. And then he has 11 values, and I'm going to only mention three that he has there. Number one, be uncompromisingly truthful. I've interviewed him a few times. I always ask him this question. If you have an investor and there's bad news, and he interrupts me, he says, "They hear it right away." Bad news travels faster than good news, and that's an honest person. Number seven, never touch dishonest dollars. It's interesting that when you buy at the courthouse steps, there's a nickname for that group, the 40 Thieves. He never was one of them. He always did everything above board. And number 11, give more than what any recipient would reasonably expect to receive. To be honest with you, that's a blueprint to become a great person, not just a wealthy person. And we have a group of people that are on video that Ward would like to say thank you for what you contributed to their life.
My buddy Ward, if there ever was the real deal, it's Ward. He'll fill in the details on how to get the deal across the finish line, and he practices what he preaches.
I just wanted to thank you for being my mentor, my teacher, my friend, and my consultant for these many years.
I remember you, Helen, and I having lunch together several years ago and you being so helpful to me. I was new in investing and I wanted to thank you for your pearly words of wisdom.
When I first moved out from Chicago and it's $60,000 to invest, I asked a repairman how to meet somebody that does notes. He recommended you. And it was a wonderful opportunity as a friendship.
One of his greatest successes that anyone can look at is how many lives he's touched, not only in business, but as a friend and a friend that cares about others and looks out for their best interests.
Ward's always been a loyal friend and a supporter, and he's inspired me when I was down. And he helped me become not only a better investor, but a better person.
Ward, you've been just a great friend and mentor for me over the decade since we've known each other. And I've gone through hundreds of transactions with your help and the lessons that I've learned from you.
You're a great friend and a great mentor and a great person.
A great guy. I appreciate all the years of his help very, very much. I learned an awful lot and was able to pass on all that knowledge to our subscribers as they called in with their questions.
His hands-on title and foreclosure training that Ward and his wife, Norris and Son Eric have provided hundreds and hundreds of investors with a solid foundation and kind of a rite of passage, really, for a lot of investors.
Thank you for all that you have done for our real estate community. All of the InnoVest alumni gatherings over the years have personally assisted me with a grand network.
Thank you so much for all that you've done over the years.
I took Ward's training in 1988. I think it was the month of August. And since that day, my life has changed tremendously. Not only we've created wealth, we've actually created a family. Ward, you're responsible for that.
I've still been doing real estate. I've been doing it every single day. I love it. And it's provided for our family. It's provided a life that's, this house we bought as a foreclosure. And it's through the original teachings of Ward Hannigan.
I think he's been a great example for me and many others of really how to take care of your family and appreciate your family.
Since August of 1988 till this day, he takes my calls. That's a guy that you want on your team.
I'd do anything for this guy. This guy really reached out and helped us, and he is the epitome of what a mentor is.
We originally met in 1984 at a seminar taught by Charlie Dorsey. Since that time, we've become great friends, and I appreciate all the help that you've given to me and all my friends, and I wish you the best in the future.
Ward, you have been an amazing coach. Norris, you make a great team. I really admire how you guys love each other, and that shows in your training and how you relate with us. It's just so beautiful.
Ward, I just got to tell you, you know, when it's all said and done, I am going to owe you such a great a debt of gratitude. You really have helped me a lot, and I really needed the help. So, you know, I continue to marvel at your materials, and I really value the mentorship and the friendship.
Ward's the best.
Thanks, Ward.
Thank you, Uncle Ward.
Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a million.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Thanks.
Thank you for all the advice you give at SDCIA.
Thank you, Ward. We love you.
It is my pleasure to present to you the second RONI Award to one of the brightest and kindest and greatest mentors that we have in our industry. Ward Hannigan. In a moment, we're going to have a picture of a house. I hope. This picture, when it arrives in any second, will represent what the industry circle has been like since the peak of the market in 2005, all the way till now. Aha. Isn't that lovely? In 2006, this is really important because what we're going to talk about tonight is what's next. In 2006, this home sold for $364,000. It's 1,400 square feet in Moreno Valley. In 2009, 3 years later, it sold for $64,000. And in 2015, it's currently pending for $264,000. The definition of market value is the most likely price that'll be arrived at when a buyer and seller, each equally motivated, equally knowledgeable, make an agreement. And then there's a little adder at the end of that, and it says the transaction absent of undue stimulus. So what's undue stimulus? Let's say we had this house pending at 265, and there was no other comps for 265. They were all 240. What an appraiser's job is to take a look at that 265 and say, why did 25 grand appear? And what if when he unearthed the transaction, it was a seller carryback loan with 0% interest for 30 years? Would that explain the extra 25 grand? That's undue transactional stimulus. In 2006, this home sold for 364. Did it have transactional undue influence? See, what you just said is important. It didn't have transactional influence. It had systemic influence, which is much more powerful. It got to 364 because of loan programs. And so it didn't have any need for transactional stimulus. There were 10 other comps just like it, and everybody else bought it for the same price. There's another kind of stimulus. It's called reverse stimulus. So in 2009, this same property sold for $64,000. Why did that happen? Because at the time, there were 50 houses for sale for every $1,000 price increment in Riverside and San Bernardino County. So we had reverse stimulus. And 64 grand, 365 turned into $64,000 on the backs of something else that occurred. It's now pending at 265. So here's a question. Does our market have undue stimulus or reverse stimulus? And what's likely to be next? So do we have undue stimulus? What do you think? Is 3.75% undue stimulus? Interest? Yeah, it is. This particular type of home had the concentration and the attention of a group of people called hedge funds. Was that undue stimulus? Okay. Now, do we have any reverse stimulus? We have a lending world that's saying no to a lot of people. And so here we are at 265. It looks like it has potential to go to 100 grand more, but then we have to go back and say, are we going to enjoy that kind of stimulus once again, or will the game be different? And so that's what tonight is about, is to talk about what's going on in the marketplace, what's the likelihood of the direction of the next stimulus. And it should be an interesting evening. We have the right panel. I want to mention that all of the panelists have really dedicated themselves to their industry. They're all spending the night away from home tonight. Not getting paid for that. It's something they do because they are willing to give of their time for this event, but also because this is the kind of people that they've been for years. They've given freely to their industry, and it's a pleasure to have them on the panel. We have David Kittle. David, and I'm going to have Doug Duncan come up next. We're going to have these two gentlemen first. And we'll have next group, and then we'll have all of them together at the end. David Kittle began his mortgage banking career in 1978 with American Fletcher Mortgage Company as a top producing loan officer. He moved to the management side in 86. He opened his own company, Associates Mortgage Group, in 1994 and selling it in 2006. Kittle is Senior Vice President of Federal Solutions for First American Mortgage Solutions, specializing in risk mitigation and analytics, based in Santa Ana, California. He manages the relationships with HUD, Ginnie Mae, the Federal Home Loan Banks, and GSEs. Kittle is past president of the Louisville and Kentucky Mortgage Bankers Association. He's past chairman of MBA's Political Action Committee, MORPAC, and former vice chairman of MBA's Residential Board of Governors. He served on MBA's Board of Directors from 2004 to 2010. And Doug Duncan. Doug is Fannie Mae's vice president and chief economist. He's responsible for managing Fannie Mae's strategy division and economics and mortgage market analysis groups. Prior to joining Fannie Mae, Duncan was senior vice president and chief economist at the Mortgage Bankers Association, recently named one of the country's top four most accurate economists in 2010 by the Wall Street Journal, and named one of Bloomberg Businessweek's 50 most powerful people in real estate. Duncan is a frequent speaker on the national and state economic, housing, and mortgage market conditions. We'd like to welcome both of you up to our panel up here. Probably just there. I think that'd be fine. It's a little bright, but if that's what it needs to be, okay. What's interesting about preparing for these questions is I read and read and read, and then I put maybe 12 or 15 pages of questions together, and I hone them down, and I think I'm all done. And then I get to the room, and I start thinking, and then I have a limo ride, and I start thinking, and I have more handwritten questions, and I probably have other questions, but that's the nature of it. And then I'm going to listen to their answers and probably come up with even better questions, I hope. So that's just the nature of it. David, you were with us in 2008, which was a humdinger of a year to have the position that you had. You said that in the following 16 months, how often were you in front of congressional meetings?
14 testimonies in 18 months.
14 testimonies, and into the teeth of quite a headwind, because no one was in the mood to hear much of anything other, maybe just to chew out the industry through you. Is that pretty accurate?
Yeah. It was a lot of red meat thrown out there.
Okay. Have we passed the vindictive state, and now have we landed in a place that's more constructive? I guess that's the best way to put it.
It's a lot better environment than it was 7-8 years ago, and it gets better every year as you move past. If you look at what happened because of that time frame, I don't know how long of an answer you want here, but what came out of that time period is what we're dealing with now, and that's the CFPB, right. Dodd-Frank, right. Came out of that. And all of those regulations, those onerous regulations, are adding a lot of cost to every loan, and the consumer's paying for it. So it's a tough environment still now. It's not as contentious as it was before, but it is much more costly than it was.
Do you have a lot of participants that just kind of bail and say, I'm going to go do something else?
I did. I mean, I had, that was a joke. I owned all or part of three lending corporations, companies, and three captive title companies over most of my career. And I think I said it, I'm pretty sure that I did the night that I was here 7 years ago, that in that particular environment, I wouldn't invest my own money then or now back and go start my own lending company today in this particular environment. So there's been a lot of consolidation. There's going to be more. And I wouldn't do it again.
Wouldn't do it again right now.
Not right now.
Well, and you also said something that's interesting. The costs are greater. There's also a condensing of what you can make on loans. So you're kind of getting hit on both sides. But one of the biggest fears in lending, isn't it, that you have to buy something back, that you have written a loan that's not perfect. And
you mean the reps and warranties?
Yeah, the reps and warranties. Yeah.
So there's a lot of repurchase going on. Repurchases are less than they have been over the last few years. Because of Dodd-Frank and the CFPB, what they want now is we're supposed to make the perfect loan. And that perfect loan means that the loan that, if I can digress just for a second, when I started as a loan officer back in the 70s, we hand-carried everything. We took the loan application. We knew our products. We closed the loan. We had no computers, no cell phones, no iPhones, no fax machines, and closed the loan in 30 days. Okay, and today we're closing the loan in 45 days, and we've got all the technology in the world because everything has been added onto it on top of regulation. So we're having to double, triple, and fourple check everything. So to answer your question, it's a tougher environment than it was before. Closings are taking longer, and the fear of repurchase has put in consolidation in the environment. When you have, and I'll finish with this, our largest players in the marketplace, like a Chase, exiting the FHA market, and there are larger banks doing the same thing because of fear of repurchase or what's going to happen when they make the loan, that gives you the state of our industry right now.
Okay. Doug, when you took a look at the picture and it went through that journey of price, 365 to 64 to 265, you have a sentiment report, basically, that if it was checking sentiment during those eras, it would be very different. So in 2015, when you measure the sentiment in the direction it's heading and if it how it's positive or negative is, what's your take on the consumer and how they feel about real estate?
Well, we survey 1,000 households a month, and there's been a lot of discussion in particular about millennials, the younger households. And very consistently.
So you do it at their mother's house, or I'm only kidding.
Well, we actually, your point being that we have the highest percentage of young people living at home that we've had. We actually surveyed the parents.
Okay. Well, it's pretty easy.
Yeah. We asked them, do you love your children? And if so, for how long? We actually did this. And they said yes for 2 to 5 years. So the story is that one of the effects of the crisis not only affected the prospects of the younger people for employment, and today's 25 to 34 year olds still have a higher unemployment rate than that same group had 10 years ago, and their median real income is $8,000 lower than that group 10 years ago. So, but the interesting thing was it was also the parents who suffered significant economic damage. So the parents of those 18 to 22-year-olds, 70% of them said this is a good thing they're living at home. A lot of that is their college age. College costs have risen twice as fast as inflation for the last 20 years. So living at home can cut college costs. That's a pretty rational and understandable experience. But 63% of those with the 23 to 34-year-olds also said it's a good thing. Turns out, when you looked at the employment prospects of the parents, they had also lost significant income earning potential in that time period. So those older kids were making a contribution to the parents' household. Still, that younger group today is the most optimistic about the investment value of homes, and over 90% of them want to own a home eventually.
Okay, eventually.
Eventually.
Okay. And that's an important word because there's in economics, there's something called an output gap. So let's say you wanted to retire at 65 and you said, if I make 8% a year, I'm going to get there at this point. And then you have the Great Recession and you take a big chunk out of it. That's sort of what happened to household creation. And your investments may not come back, but it's pretty certain that that 28 or 35-year-old will someday have a household. And that means we have pent-up household creation at some point that's going to show up. What do you think that time frame is? Is that more economic than it is habit-formed?
It is economic. take that real median income story that I just told you. The household formation rate for the first half of this decade was roughly half of the 35-year-old average, 35-year average, which is about 1.2 million households per year. So for the first half of this decade, it was about half that rate.
Okay.
It started to grow, and our expectation is the second half it will get back to that average, which means there's still catch-up to be done going into the next decade. So from a demographic perspective, the U.S. actually has a pretty good demographic profile. The millennials are even a larger group than the boomers were.
Right.
So looking forward, the prospects for real estate are strong.
For demand, absolutely. Okay. I couldn't resist this one. I was thought, like, if I think back, what was full employment? Like, what was the number? And I thought it was 5. Mm-hmm. Okay. So we are now at 5%-ish unemployment and a 2% 10-year T-bill.
Yeah, that's a bogus number.
Well, of course it is, but maybe, okay. Go ahead. You mean we're not counting some people?
Oh, you know, you count the people that left the workforce, but I mean, you know, the real number is, you know, north of 11%, I guess, right? Something close to that.
If you look, if you count the underemployed.
Oh, if you count those other people out there, yeah, that's right.
Now here's a legitimate question.
I got a call.
Go ahead.
From my son, who's a junior at the University of Kentucky. I live in Kentucky. And he said, hey, Dad, I got straight A's this semester. I said, wow, Zach, that's great. You've been a C student. What happened? He said, I just threw out 3 tests on each class.
And that was it, huh? Well, now, but see, is it consistently been that way, or is that a new development? So when I look at the chart from 75 or 80, or are they telling me a lie at that point? So then the chart is consistently incorrect, and I feel comfortable with it.
You're the numbers guy.
Well, yeah, there's lies, damn lies, and statistics.
Right.
Right.
So, well, so why don't you give us some lying statistics?
The why I bring it up, because the last time we don't have 5% unemployment very often.
Right.
But when we did it in 97 to 01, the 10-year T-bill was ranged in that 4 years between 5 and 6.5, and mortgage rates were 6.75 to 8.5. And that's pretty consistent. We got there in 73 and another time, but the mortgage rates were 7 to 8.5, and now they're below 4. So as an economist, you know, what do you think of that? Why is that true? Those sets of numbers have never existed before, 5% unemployment and this interest rate.
Well, underneath your description is an assumption that what is called the Phillips curve is a valid economic concept.
Okay.
And what the Phillips curve is there was an economist named Phillips who suggested there is a trade-off, a mathematically dependable trade-off, between the level of unemployment and the level of inflation. So that if unemployment falls below a certain level, that will lead to wage pressures that will show up in the inflation measures. That was actually pretty well discredited in the 1980s. I think it's being discredited again today. That doesn't stop the Federal Reserve, who is primarily a Keynesian-oriented organization, from viewing that as a key measure for what they do with interest rates. To talk a little bit about the structure of our workforce, though, to validate Dave's comment about whether people are actually being counted, the workforce participation rate of working age men has been falling for about 40 years. And by that, that's men the ages of 16 to 54. It was disguised until the year 2000 by the fact that the workforce participation of working age women was rising.
Okay.
Their participation peaked in 2000, and so the workforce participation rate in total has been declining since 2000. It became precipitous in the middle of the crisis, and it still hasn't recovered from there. So really one of the key questions is, why is that the case? And that's not well understood. And so you're referring to Janet Yellen's comments that say, well, I think there's actually more slack in the market. And truthfully, if you look at the number of working age people, there is more slack. The question is, what will happen in terms of wage rates to bring them back into the market? And go back to that comment I made about the real incomes of 25 to 34-year-olds. That's not happening. What needs to be done, and this is Doug's view, it's why Fannie Mae always makes me put up this disclaimer that says Fannie Mae will deny I was ever here. I used to give them a reason. The focus of economic policy needs to be on income creation as opposed to income redistribution. Because what has happened, it's always the case in a strongly growing economy that the distribution of those returns is different across the span of households. But we've had for the last several years a focus on the redistribution issue, and there's no long-term evidence that if that's the focus of policy, incomes grow, and they certainly have not grown for roughly the last decade.
But I thought the best way to raise income was just to raise it, like just raise the minimum wage, so I...
You're talking in front of the right group on that one.
So.
You're not going to touch that one.
I was not here tonight either. So.
You know,
was that our wives leaving?
I think so.
We've been waiting and waiting for an interest rate hike. And then, just for fun, I pulled up the concept of negative interest rates. And so, what is a negative interest rate, and is that a policy that could be implemented, and what would the result be? Anybody?
Well, you see negative interest rates, both nominal and real, that is, including inflation and not in some significant countries in Europe,
right.
Some major economies.
Right.
What does that mean? It basically means people paying the government to hold their cash for
right.
the short term. I have to say, none of the economic textbooks I was trained on suggested that was even a remote possibility.
Yeah.
So this is kind of uncharted territory. The way I think about it is kind of ties back to a call I got from my mother when TARP was voted down the first time. She said, Douglas, which means I'm in trouble. If it was Douglas George, I'd have hung up. said, we paid our mortgage. What are you people doing with our money? Right? The result of that has been that she gets 0.25% interest on her savings.
Right.
And she's 90.
Right.
So there's inflation, which you were talking about in the example you gave in the 70s and
right.
80s, destroys the purchasing power of your dollar, right? So a dollar today, if there's inflation of 5%, you can buy 5% less with it a year from now. If financial repression, which is what I would argue is being done with negative interest rates and interest rates arbitrarily close to zero, has essentially the same effect in that it's destroying income growth. And so you're actually taking away from the public the ability to preserve or expand their wealth. And that's really what's happening today.
It's beneficial for an asset like real estate or a stock.
It is.
Okay.
It is. But in the short run.
Right.
In the long run, that's...
Well, I guess that's kind of the... We've kind of pegged ourselves... I wouldn't want to read... Where's the national price right now as opposed to the last peak?
The
national housing price?
Average sale price?
Yeah. Or not... I think it's the median. It's close. It's close enough to the peak that it's sort of on the backs of this 3% mortgage rate. See, that's sort of hard because if you ever normalize rates, and I'm sure at some point we will, there's an equation that's going to come about where the payment is going to be greater than than somebody can qualify for.
Sure. So can I digress just for
sure,
second?
Sure, please.
All kidding aside, so my wife, who's with me here tonight, we are blessed to have four healthy children. And very blessed. Two girls, two boys, all millennials, 35 to 21. And two of them are homeowners, both the girls. They both have college degrees. The boys are struggling. So whatever that means. So our youngest daughter, Paige, relocates with her husband this week to Honolulu because he flies helicopters for the Coast Guard, and they bought their first home this week, all right? A four-bedroom, if that's what you want to call it, four little, I've seen it online, four little boxes for a room in Hawaii for $600,000+. It's her first house. And she's calling me. I'm getting emails while we're sitting over here. Would you look at this disclosure? Do I sign this? I'm going, I don't know, I guess.
You're not in that business anymore.
It had trid all over it. I don't know what the hell it meant. So, but think about that. First-time home buyers at 25 years old buying a house for almost $600,000+. But it's because of low interest rate, and he's getting a bump in income through the military, or they couldn't afford to live over there.
Now,
so,
okay.
It's low interest rates. Okay, we don't have a free market. I'll just say it. When you have manipulated interest rates now for what, 7 years?
Yeah.
6.5, 7 years?
Yeah.
It's 0%. If you want it to be free, we need to let interest rates go to wherever they need to go. And the market will adjust around it. And so will incomes. And to Doug's point, people who are on Social Security or investments or whatever, then those interest rates will rise. But we've manipulated everything for the last 6.5 or 7 years and held it down. So we really don't know where we are at this point.
The big price tag there, too, is you've got promises to retired workers who expected that
unfunded mandates.
Right. But they expected this journey of interest rate to be there. And for
so
that
what came out this week? There's no raise in Social Security.
Right.
How
That's
about
right.
That?
Yeah.
Aren't they happy?
Yeah.
Just a comment on interest rate behavior. If you think back to the taper tantrum in May of 2013, Chairman Bernanke talked for the first time about the fact that the Fed would eventually stop purchasing mortgage-backed securities and treasuries to expand their portfolio. So simply the statement led to about 110 basis point rise in
right.
mortgage rates. So what happened at the beginning of 2014? Home sales fell, right? So there is a relationship between income growth and interest rate change. If interest rate, the long-term interest rate, take out the last 5 years of the 1970s, and you go back to the end of World War II out to the year 2000, the average 30-year fixed rate mortgage was 6%.
Okay.
Housing did pretty well growing over that entire time period, right? But incomes also grew pretty well. What happened in the taper tantrum is that the interest rates rose much faster than incomes did, so it put people out of the market. It wasn't that house prices fell, it's that the number of homes sold fell. Then when rates came back down over the next 6 months, the pace of sales picked up. So there's an important lesson there. It is the change in rates relative to the change in incomes. So again, the fact that we've had very little change in real income in the people that would be the first time home buying category is part of the reason we've seen the move over to the rental side of the equation. But there's a couple other things about interest rates and housing. If interest rates are rising because the economy is expanding, that usually means real incomes are rising and housing does just fine as long as it's not a rapid rise in rates.
Okay.
If interest rates are rising because households expect inflation to be rising, They view housing as an intermediate term hedge against inflation, and housing does just fine. If interest rates are rising because the Fed sees inflation increasing and is trying to slow the economy, that also slows employment and income growth, and then the number of homes transacted falls, but not price. Note, I didn't say anything about price in any of that. So there's a pretty well-established pattern between rate behaviors. A lot of what's critical is the pace of change of rates and the pace of change in incomes.
The pace of change is not usually slow, right? And that's just in looking at the history of when something decides to go up, it's like it has change after change after change, and the volatility is, it can be quite severe. Not severe might be, I got into the business in 80, 81, and there were 21 Fed fund rate changes in 1 year. So this group of people are completely not used to volatility at all.
Well, that goes back to what Dave was saying about whether it's a function of market changes or a function of monetary policy. So what you're talking about is rapid rate rises by the Fed.
Is that what I said?
That's what you said.
Oh.
Okay. I've been taking notes.
Good.
You'll be on the quiz.
I'm glad.
You can drop three.
Good. I feel pretty. Thank you. I feel smart tonight sitting next to you, let me tell you.
We've only got a couple more minutes for this segment, so I just wanted to ask, because the group of here is investors, I have to ask about bulk note sales for just a second, and Fannie Mae. You guys still have bulk note sales, correct?
I've heard.
You've heard of that? Okay. Why is that still occurring in a market that doesn't have a lot of foreclosures? Is that the highest and best use to get rid of them, or is it the best way for the occupant owner still to get some kind of modification be possible?
Well, in those sales are highly concentrated geographically.
Right? Okay.
I mean, the majority of our seriously delinquent loans are in really three states.
Right, Jersey, Florida, and whatever.
Yeah,
Not California.
in Nevada.
Okay.
So it's the question is whether there's sufficient demand in those spaces to see the kind of price recovery that you would see in other parts of the country, and the answer is no. The bulk sales are affected in a way that's intended to help potential sustainable homeowners ultimately take those properties and live in them. But I can see where you would want to go with this, which is why not let private investors into that space?
Just another route. In other words, I looked at it was 37 months to that bulk sale.
This is why Fannie Mae says they'll deny that I was ever here.
Okay.
Because I would agree with you. I'm a market-oriented economist. And I think part of the problem that we're still seeing in the housing market is that prices were not allowed to be market determined in many instances, but rather were managed.
Right.
Excuse me.
Okay. Last question for this segment. Within the next 24 months, do you see any ability for the mortgage world to become more aggressive with loan products and policies within the next 24 months? That undue stimulus that we're looking for, or not looking for, but in other words, is that going to be a factor that isn't present now, in your opinion?
So I answer it this way, in all seriousness. If you believe MBA statistics, which I do, the greatest portion of home buyers will be Hispanic or African American. The white guys sitting here like Doug and I and you, we're going to be at the low end of it. They need loan programs developed so they can purchase the house.
Okay.
They don't exist today for some of the people that are buying. So here's the answer to your question. The market is set to explode from a single family purchase perspective over the next, and I'm going to go out farther than you, 6 to 8 years. It should explode.
In between then
demand.
Or starting then?
Starting then.
Starting then.
Yeah,
okay,
so
5 years from now. Okay.
Incomes are down. Interest rates have to be released and go up. I'm not an economist. Doug can correct me if I'm wrong. It has a negative effect initially when rates go up, you get an initial bump. When rates start to go up, everybody gets off the fence, they run out and buy. Look at what we see today, the statistics that came out this week. We are still in a decreased type of economy in Philadelphia Fed and Chicago Fed. It's below where it should be. Job creation is still low. Here's how I'm going to answer your question. We'll have a lousy market for the next 18 months.
Okay.
Okay. And then we have an election, depending on however it goes, and I'm not calling it either way, then you're going to see some change.
Okay.
And the market will come back. But it's poised to take off, and we're going to have a very hot market for anywhere between now and the next 8 years. From a single family purchase perspective, that's my prediction.
Okay.
I was just going to comment on your credit conditions, part of your question. We survey lenders on a quarterly basis, we do that in part to understand whether lenders have different views than consumers, and also because the only other data out there on that is the Fed survey, which is heavily weighted toward large banks. And in the most recent quarter, there was a statistically significant easing of credit conditions among particularly large and mid-size institutions. To Dave's point, though, in the FHA space, there's been a big shift away from that market by the big lenders. We've actually seen that in our data at Fannie as well. The share of the business from the large lenders has fallen from about two-thirds to about one-third over the last 3 years or so. So it's actually the larger the smaller institutions, which are better at finding those people that Dave's talking about and delivering the opportunity. So we're optimistic about it as well.
Can I give you 10 seconds?
Yeah, sure.
Way down in the weeds on this. You have the big banks pulling out of the FHA market because they're worried about repurchase, okay? I'm an underwriter. I used to be an underwriter for FHA loans. You used to be able to make a business decision on an FHA loan. If somebody had a one-time life event, they didn't make their payments because their wife had cancer. Document it, make the loan, sign it, close it. They had 30 credit cards that they charged up, you didn't make the loan. You can still make that decision today, but you won't make that decision today because you're afraid of repurchase. There are people out there today, regardless of their ethnicity, that are 550 credit scores that deserve to be homebuyers. They're afraid to make those loans because of the repurchase. I'm talking about FHA.
Okay.
You can't make a business decision anymore on a loan based on performance because of the repurchase threat. It's still there. I talk to my friends in the business who still own companies. They've risked everything they have. They're not the big banks, they're lenders. Everything they have is tied up in their company, and they're afraid to make that loan that should be made.
Right, and so they don't.
So they don't make it.
Okay, and that has ramifications because that person, if they had gotten own a home 2 years ago, would have 30, 40% equity and have a running start of being an entrepreneur or whatever. That's a big deal. Mm-hmm. One of the things, and then we'll wrap up with this, is that when you invited us to Washington, D.C., I got in front of one of the HUD gentlemen, and I said, you used to be able to do simple assumptions. You know, I didn't have to qualify, I was just sending $35 my name. He said, I don't have any problem with that. And I said, can you put that in writing for me? He says, no, I can't do that. Thank you, gentlemen, Thank you very much. Oh, I thought I was going to go to a podium. Next up, we'll have three panelists, and they can all come up together after I read the bios. Leslie Appleton Young. Leslie is Vice President and Chief Economist for the California Association of Realtors, a statewide trade organization with over 195,000 members dedicated to the advancement of professionalism in real estate. It got noisy. She directs the activities of the association's member information group and oversees the analysis of the housing market, brokerage industry trends, member communications, and membership development activities. She is also closely involved in the association's strategic planning efforts and is a well-known speaker in California real estate community. We have Eileen Reynolds. Eileen is a vice president for government affairs at Tejon Ranch Company, a diversified real estate development and ag business, an owner of the largest contiguous piece of private property in California, located between LA and Bakersfield. The company is committed to responsibly using its 270,000 acres of land and resources to meet the housing, employment, and lifestyle needs of Californians. Reynolds manages the company's political advocacy efforts in Sacramento and Washington, D.C. Reynolds serves in a variety of leadership positions at CBIA. She is also an active director of the California Business Properties Association and president of the Foundation for Environmental and Economic Progress at the federal level. And last but not least, our friend Sean O'Toole. Prior to launching Property Radar, Sean O'Toole successfully purchased and flipped more than 150 residential and commercial foreclosures. Leveraging 15 years in the software industry, Sean used technology as a key competitive advantage to build his successful real estate investment track record. Sean has always thrived in startup environments and as such became a key contributor at Xing Technology, acquired by Real Networks, ISI Global Center, acquired by Global Crossing, and Icarian Inc., acquired by Workstream Inc. We welcome all of our panelists, please, up to our board. I think maybe all over to my left is better. That would be, I can look at all three of you at the same time that way. Okay, interesting stuff. Sean, I'm gonna start with you because it's gonna then go to Leslie in a follow-up question.
Set me up.
When Ward used to first teach trustee sale buying, it was a very different journey to get to the opening bid, getting the updates and all that. You kind of revolutionized all that. You took what you knew in the computer world and you plugged it in to the foreclosure business. So what were the ramifications of that as far as if you were a participant trying to buy at those trustee sales? Let's talk about that first and then go to Property Radar and kind of the same journey with now the extended statistics that you deal with.
You know, it's interesting. I actually think it comes back to the employment participation rate that's been going down since for the last 40 years.
You're responsible for that?
Well, yeah, kind of. You know, I started in the software business when I was 14, and reflecting back on that and the things that I've done in that industry, most of what I've done is make things more efficient.
Right.
Which means you need fewer people.
Right.
And I would say more than anything else, that was the change we made. You needed fewer people to track sales, you know. Just one gentleman I can think of, you know, came up to me and said, you know, geez, I used to have three people full-time tracking the sales in two counties. And now I have them doing other things for me. So it made them a lot more efficient.
The information access also made somebody get up to speed much quicker. They were able to go from 0 to 95 inside a very tight time period, which was not true before. But also the cost of access changed. It used to be thousands of dollars a year, and you know, and then it turned into what, $50. And so you had a lot more people able to do that now.
I was probably a little too desperate.
Oh, to get people
on the pricing.
Yeah, those of us who are trying to buy at trustee sales would agree with that. How is access to information, and this is for Leslie, how has access to information for the consumer kind of changed the world of realtors? Because I would think most of them are sort of self-shopping until a much later point than they used to.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's all on the internet, and if it's on the internet, it's true, right? We all know that. And so I think there's a wealth of information out there. There's not always a lot of wisdom and ability to kind of analyze and figure out what to do, which is why even everyone in this room has access to the same information. I mean, everybody's got Google and this, that, and the other thing, and yet you have wonderful teachers, you know, who make a difference in people's lives because there's just different ways of thinking about things and analyzing things. So, you know, the realtor used to be the key to the information, and I think, you know, you'd be looking for a home in the 80s, and there'd be this big giant book with like grainy black and white pictures, and your realtor would go, I'm going to give this to you over the weekend, but don't tell anyone or I'll go to jail, right? And so, you know, what's happened is the whole value of the realtor really isn't about finding the home. It's really about navigating the whole transaction. And I think your prior, the prior panel really talked about how difficult that is today, even with all the efficiencies and programs and technology, you know, to get from point A to point B is a lot.
The makeup of the buyer now, as far as the household that's buying a property, you know, when I was growing up, it was the married couple and the 2.3 kids or something like that. And now that's a very different makeup of who is having to, or who's trying to buy a home. And many times they're now one adult worker per household. And so how has that changed, I guess, what they're able to buy and their willingness to either buy or just say, I'm going to have to rent?
Well, I think that's probably a segue into the housing affordability crisis, which we're facing again today. It seems to be kind of on a 10-year 10-year cycle. I think the home ownership rate for millennials is about 20%, and many of them had boomer parents that were able to write checks to get them in, so that down payment hurdle is really, really tough. But you also just have a flourishing of, I don't even want to call it alternative lifestyles, you know, but you know, 30, 40 years ago, it was the mom and the dad and the two kids, and now it's people actually choosing to be single because it's less stressful for some people. You know, you have same-sex couples and partners, and all, everybody's great, you know, so it's just a very diverse, diverse world. I think the one point I want to make, and Doug made some really great comments about millennials, and you know, millennials really do want to buy homes, but they have, because of the economy and their codependent boomer parents, have really delayed adulthood by about 10 years. So now that we've got household formation coming, you know who you are. I am one. You know who you are. But now that they're starting, now that we are seeing a pickup in household formation, job creation in California is much faster than it is for the nation, and so on and so forth, you're seeing more home ownership actually happening for millennials. And I do agree with David. I think you are going to have kind of a renaissance, you know, once we get through the next couple of years, because they're going to have families, and once you have kids, you have a whole different attitude about home ownership, and you really have to focus on schools.
We're going to revisit affordability in a minute, because that's one of my favorite topics, and Sean and I have been batting it around, but Eileen, I want to welcome you to the panel for the first time.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We appreciate you being here. And honestly, it seems to be really appropriate. There was, on your bio, talk about that big project where you have 270,000
Tejon Ranch. I'm the vice president for government affairs for Tejon Ranch Company. Many of you would know that on the grapevine if you drive I-5, the road that's shut down today. our employees couldn't go to the job today because our headquarters is in Lebec, that Mecca. But I work for a large land developer, agribusiness company. That's my day job, and I'm based in Sacramento, but my volunteer job is I'm the chairperson of the California Building Industry Association this year.
And
so we have some builders here, or somebody who cares about building. Thank you.
And to be able to develop that project, there was 240,000 acres of that that was sort of put in conservative.
Well, what we did, Bruce, is we entered into negotiations with five environmental groups. It started with six. One group is notorious for litigating every future development there is in anywhere in the nation. It's called the Center for Biological Diversity. We were in two-year negotiations with these five environmental groups, and I mean big ones, Sierra Club, Natural Resources Defense Council, Planning Conservation League, and others. And we were in the confidential negotiations over our property for a good 14 months, and then Center for Biological Diversity saw that there wasn't going to be an agreement and decided they needed to leave the table because that wasn't their style. They'd prefer to roll up their sleeves and sue people. So, what we did was we have three development, really four development projects. If you've driven over the Grapevine, if you're going south, about to ascend the Tejon Pass, we have the Commerce Center, Tejon Ranch Commerce Center at the base of the Grapevine, where the new outlets at Tejon is located, if any of you have the time to stop. And then we're going to build a master plan community there called Grapevine of about 12,000 units. You go up the mountain into Lebec, and we're going to do a second home community called Tone Mountain Village, which will be about 3,000 units in some of our most beautiful stretches of land. And then further down the freeway in Los Angeles County to the north, about 19,000 units in a master plan community called Centennial. Now, so there is actually something that could happen as far as new development in California, but from the standpoint of the industry I'm representing tonight, one of the toughest things to do in California, as you all know, is to build anything in this state.
Is the role of the environmental sector going to become more of an issue in the next few years? And we have a Governor Brown that seems to be pretty aggressive in some of his stances. 50% of our electricity coming up is supposed to be renewable. So how does that add, how does that change for the builder, you know, what they're able to do and able to get approved?
Well, I would argue that they've been strong here for as long as most of us have been alive. I mean, when all the environmental laws came into effect in the 70s, California was at the forefront of it, and we continue to be, especially now, as you mentioned, we have a governor and a pro tem of the state senate that want to make California be the climate change leader of the world. So they want to reduce greenhouse gases, and they want to ratchet down on every sector in our economy, including development. So we saw some bills in the legislature this year that essentially we believe, one, that we were able to stall for the time being, that would have essentially required that if you're going to create a new home, it's got to be zero net energy, meaning it doesn't use any energy. It has to be able to turn back to the grid. We haven't figured out exactly how to do that yet. And one of the things that we ended up having to pay quite a great deal of money to commission a study by some experts who were from both sides of the aisle, both Republican and Democrat, former experts of the Department of Finance and the Legislative Analyst Office. And they brought us a study that said, well, if you want to try to be zero net energy, it's going to be at least $58,000 per unit. And that's in addition to a lot of the other societal problems that are put on the backs of new home buyers, such as, you know, increased taxes. Right now, there's a big movement on housing affordability where we've seen some communities, the courts have said there needs be no nexus between local government's ability to raise money on new development for housing affordability programs. In some areas of the state, they're raising fees up to $30,000 to $60,000 per unit to pay for affordable housing that doesn't need to even be related to the provision of what the new developer is doing. So we have a situation in California specifically where, yes, our legislature is against us from the get-go, and at the same time, we've already have layers of regulation upon the industry. And one of the people earlier said to me, well, my gosh, it's as if people want to outlaw any growth in California. And I think there are people that do believe that. That would really rather not see any growth, because if you don't build it, potentially they won't come. But as many of you know, we've got, you know, in some cases, I've heard, this is not my forte, because I'm working for a land developer, but there are places in existing neighborhoods where, you know, two and three families are living in one house. Well, that's not addressing our housing crisis. We need to build more.
Um, Leslie or Sean, the water issue that's, you know, one of the things, I mean, I'm very suspicious of radical elements on either side of a fence, to be honest with you. But this is sort of like a real drought, and it seems like there's a real chance to say, okay, well, here are the rules, and we're going to fine you a whole bunch of dollars if you don't do stuff. And I start to be concerned about the building industry just being told you can't build anything new because that's going to use water. Sean, are you concerned at all that type of mood could reach into the investor world and say, okay, well, you have a rental that you know, there's water on the sidewalk, and they have a system where you get told on. That's my concern, is the investor might be the target, sort of like the tall grass thing that we got some vines on. So just any input on
why not?
Why not?
I don't mean that it should, but I mean that certainly seems to be the mentality. I mean, on the affordable housing thing, how anybody thinks housing in California can be more affordable by adding fees to new housing for affordable housing? You're increasing the cost of housing to make affordable housing. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense.
And when you can have that, it was our Supreme Court in the state of California that opined on that, and we're appealing it to the U.S. Supreme Court.
So, I mean, to the degree that you have that kind of, you know, inane argument that in order to have affordable housing, we need to add fees to housing, it just doesn't pass the smell test on logic scale, right? You know, can you have other ridiculous arguments? I think absolutely. I think we're going to face lots of them.
I just want to add here, though, you know, I think it's great and fine, and you can point the finger at government, but I think the whole not in my backyard attitude is a huge part of the issue. And anyone that drives the freeways in Southern California, I think, has every right to feel that we can't have one more housing unit in Southern California, right? But this isn't rocket science. There are global capitals with examples galore. It's high-density development along viable transportation corridors. And unless you're going to have a one-child rule or deal with population growth in another way, you've got to get rational about new construction. Because I'll tell you what's going to happen. Part of the explosion that David was going to talk about in the market in 4, 5, and 6, 8 years is not going to happen in California. It's happening in Texas and Denver and Seattle and Portland, because that's where the young families can go and actually buy affordable housing. They're not going to be able to do it in Southern California, and I think that's a real shame. You know, Eileen's at Tejon Ranch. You're not dealing with existing homeowners, but developers that are. I mean, let's face it, CEQA is the go-to place for I'm going to sue and stop this development. You know, so it's also us. You know, it's not just the environmentalists and not just the government. It's the public not really being able to envision a different future.
May I add one thing?
Yes, sure.
One thing I think I can say is if we're successful at Tejon Ranch, we will have affordable housing, but it wasn't for some sacrifice. And one place we didn't get to was, you know, sure, we signed this agreement that says we're going to set aside 90% of our land for the environment. But what we did was what we did in that is we got those five nationwide environmental groups to say they would stand down in a CEQA process. So they're not going to challenge our developments. And if they do anything near that, we can, you know, knock them down and stop them from that. So we will be able to develop these areas without being nickel and dimed to death by these environmentalists. But I mean, we didn't give up land over it, but we gave up the ability to develop our other future land holdings as a result.
I mean, at the end of the day, there's places in Texas where you can build a house for the cost of a permit in certain places in California.
That's right.
Which is pathetic, yes.
So if you want to address affordable housing and that type of thing, I completely agree with Leslie. You also have to think about infrastructure. And nobody, I live in Tahoe. You want to talk about a not in my backyard. You know, we're trying to build a school up there right now. And, you know, we've got folks in one of the highest end communities living on a golf course, which, you know, golf's great, but it's not like a really, you know, sound environmental use of land, I don't think. And, you know, and here they are with their golf course home saying, well, we don't want you to develop this land. Well, that land was entitled for a school. We're not asking for a zoning change or anything else. It's been entitled for a school forever. And they're saying, no. I'm saying, well, okay, how about I show up with the bulldozer at your house tomorrow and let's convert that back to wilderness first? I mean, it is, to Leslie's point, it's not a reasonable argument this, you know, if a piece of land is entitled and should be allowed, it should be able to be built. And we've got a second guessing of that on everything, and that just adds a lot of cost to the process. So maybe we need to put our hands up and say, look, do-over, we're going to we're going to think about the master plan here and kind of re-entitle everything and come up with some sort of compensation for those people who gain and the people who lose. But this current situation where you've got people with land that's properly zoned and entitled having to face years, there's one folks that just trying to get develop some property in Truckee. They've been at it for 20 years.
Wow.
Trying to get their property entitled. And the folks aren't wealthy, you know, they're not doing well. It's not some rich developer, you know, they have this gift of some land, but they can't do anything with it. And 20 years, that's not fair, that's not right.
No. We've run out of time for this segment. I do want to circle back around the affordability question and with the rest of the panel. So we'll take a dessert break right now, and yep. Then we'll be come back up here.
We'll be back at 9 o'clock.
I know. He's doing great. So good.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's about time. We will be resuming our session this evening very shortly, so please take your seat. One more time, please take your seat. We will be resuming our session this evening very shortly.
The Norris Group would like to thank its gold sponsors for supporting I Survived Real Estate. Adrenaline Athletics, Coachella Valley Real Estate Investors Association, Coldwell Banker Town and Country, Elite Auctions, iMortgage, In a Day Development, Inland Valley Association of Realtors, Jennifer Buys Houses, Keller Williams Corona, Keystone CPA, Kukan and Clark, Las Brisas Escrow, LA South REIA, Leivas Tax Wealth Management, National REIA, Northern California Real Estate Investors Association, North San Diego Real Estate Investors, Pasadena FIBI, Pilot Limousine, Orange County FIBI, Real Wealth Network, Realty 411 Magazine, Resonant Lens Photography, Rick and LeAnne Rossiter, Sacramento Real Estate Club, Capital City Wealth Builders, Southern California Chapter of the Appraisal Institute, SONOCA Corporation, Spinnaker Loans, Tri-Counties Association of Realtors, uDirect IRA Services, Westin South Coast Plaza, Wilson Investment Properties, Inc.
Ready to go. I don't have a way to do that. I think it just came on.
Thing in California where they want to add a fee to every document you record.
I don't think this is going to work.
Yeah. That's not very effective.
There we go. Thank you. Behave. Okay, we've got probably 55 minutes, and we'll try to utilize it. During the break, it was suggested I ask a question, and it's all in our best interest. A lot of the people in the audience are risk takers, investors. They use leverage, and so they're very interested in the panel's take on: do we have a bubble forming, or are we at that point where we have some concern about prices declining from here? And I'll open that to anybody that wants to take it on first. And I'm gonna add some elements to that as we go through the question or the answer of the question. So
okay, well, I'll start and I'll just say never say never. The homes that are being bought today are being purchased by people with real incomes, real down payments, real money, and as we've noted earlier, they're getting real mortgages with fairly strict underwriting. So the things that were happening that kind of led up to the, 2007, 2008 meltdown are really not in play, but it doesn't mean that things couldn't happen that would impact housing prices. For example, are equities overvalued? Some people would say absolutely yes.
Okay.
Are all of the companies in Silicon Valley that are providing, these incredible gains to their employees, is that sustainable? Do their valuations make sense? And what happens if there were a big adjustment, which is possible? So there are kind of ripple effect things that could happen, but in terms of it coming from kind of inside, like rotting from the inside, I don't think we have those conditions today.
Okay. Now, can I offer a bubble might be, let's say, the end of a pricing cycle and not be accompanied by a crash necessarily. But that's what you're saying. There's none of that.
Right. And understand, I think it's great to focus on rates, but, you've also got 25% of the market all cash or whatever the, number varies from area to area. So that's a little higher than we've typically seen.
Okay.
I was going to give a reading assignment to go along with the quiz.
Okay.
John Williams, the president of the San Francisco Fed, wrote it, and it's on their website, something called an economic newsletter. It's basically a speech that he did, where the title is Monetary Policy and House Prices. And so it's about 6 pages long. It doesn't have any equations in it. And otherwise, I wouldn't be referencing it. But inferentially, he asked the question, if you believe that the price of an asset is the net present value of its discounted cash flows, then given where interest rates are, do you think asset values are overvalued?
Okay.
So it's worth reading and thinking about that, because that would be the interest rate play.
Sean and you and I were talking about in the limo where you had a San Francisco house that was, $3.5 million, and it was a rental value of $6,500. Then we equated that the tax value of that house had to have a tax bill of whatever.
Half the rental income.
Half of the rental income, so his net yield was 1.5%.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a little crazy in the valley again.
Okay.
I think big picture on this bubble question, I think one thing we have to keep in mind is that homes are less affordable today than they were in 2006.
And explain,
right? The basic definition of affordable is how many people can afford a home today. In 2006, anybody with a pulse could afford a home. The stat says that we had 17% affordability, but really, what do we have? 80% affordability in 2006? There's no question that homes are less affordable today and that we are more overpriced given lending terms and income,
okay,
than we were in 2006.
Now,
so
you're really
how
hurting
do you define
me.
A bubble?
That's one of the things I count on is that affordability chart. And Sean and I bounced this around this week. So I look at that affordability chart. It has similar endings, and you've all heard me discuss that. And one of the things that I definitely was concerned about is you could have a very different affordability this time because of the just saying no to so many people and the inability to make price progression. We also have some other elements that are kind of in play for the first time. The bulk buyers, the single family conglomerates, if they decide to exit, I'm just curious, are we concerned about them being market makers as they go out as they were as they came in? Any takers on that one?
I'll just jump in from this standpoint, which is you know, after that period of inflation that Doug, you know, referred to earlier, we hit a point where we were very used to high interest rates, and through that period of inflation in the late 70s, we pretty much wiped out debt. And that allowed us to grow the economy for the last 35 years now through cheaper and, you know, cheaper debt. And by growing the economy, I think mostly through the growth of debt. And we've hit the zero bound of that. And what does that mean? I think there's a much bigger issue at play here than just the housing cycle. And I think you have to start putting things in that context. If you look at Japan, where I think, what is it, a 1.5% 35-year mortgage, is that am I roughly right there, is the standard? If we're headed into that kind of environment because of these bigger picture issues, we can't raise interest rates. We have too much national debt. How do we pay that back without accelerating deficit, you know, making things worse? So if we're now in a permanently low interest rate environment, will we look back 5 years from now and go, you know what, 2%, 3% return on a house looks pretty good? Mm-hmm. So, on the one hand, I think we're less affordable than ever and more of a bubble than ever. On the other hand, I think in this kind of environment, if they don't, you know, lose the game and we stay in this low interest rate environment, it could get worse or better, depending on what you want to see happen.
Do we have any concern? This is one of the things that's been brought up here all the time when I speak, is the concern about the maturing of the equity lines, to where there people are now going to have to start paying on the equity line and not have access to it, but now it's turning into a 15-year loan. So are there enough of those to impact price somewhere?
I'll jump in again.
Okay.
Yes, there is.
Really?
However, think about the world we live in which, you know, banks are no longer held to regulatory standards that say you have to clean up bad assets. They say instead, do everything you can to protect and help the homeowner. So if we get into a position where those HELOCs start to have default issues, at the end of the day, there's going to be, you know, protection for those homeowners and protection, you know, from taking those, recognizing those losses. So I don't think it's going to be an issue. Big picture, I don't think it'll be an issue. Is there an opportunity for folks who want to go after those? Will they find some folks that have fear, hit those payment crisis and the rest, and, you know, potentially do a deal? I think so. Will it impact some individuals? I absolutely think so. Will it be a big downturn? No, I don't think so.
Yeah, that was really the gist of it, was a systemic danger. Could you have enough of those to where you have a price decline on the backs of that?
Sorry, I'll take a breath.
Okay.
Can I go out on a limb?
Sure.
I'll say something controversial.
How unusual.
I don't think we ever came out of the recession.
Okay.
And so I ran this by Doug, and he didn't bless this, but I...
He's not here.
But Doug's not here, and I'm not either, but I... outside, you know, we were standing there talking, and so here's how I equate things, and just bear with me for like 15 seconds. So I've been a pilot for 30 plus years, right? So I equate everything to flying an airplane, whether or not you, when you have altitude, you have everything, right? Don't hit the ground. It's been like you take off and you're not quite in CG, center of gravity, and the plane just won't climb. And we've been just like this for the last 6.5 years, and I cannot get this thing up and get it going. So if you put that into perspective, let me go way down in the weeds. When you talk about millennials, my kids sitting around the table wanting to buy a house, your children wanting to buy a house, first-time home buyers so people can move up, real interest rates, doesn't matter what interest rates do. Okay, forget about interest rates for a second. Think about what they are thinking about at the table, and that is their incomes aren't real, they're not going up, and they have that one thing that hangs out there, and here's the controversial statement. They have the increasing cost and fees of health care around them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
So I'm really going to throw this out on a real huge limb, and then I'll back down, I promise. In the state of Kentucky, we have a governor that embraced Affordable Health Care Act.
Okay.
All right? Don't tense up. But just think about it, how it affects everybody. They raided Medicare for $500 billion to pay for the states that did the exchanges. In Kentucky, that money runs out next year. It runs out in every state next year. Well, how are they going to pay for it? We have a governor's race coming up. They're going to pay for it by raising taxes. The average cost of health care is about $500 increase on average in Kentucky, which is not a lot of money compared to what you guys pay here in California. But think of it in perspective. That's a lot of money for somebody, a young millennial sitting around a table. It's the difference between buying a car and buying a house.
Yeah.
So you really get down in the weeds about where we're going with all this and the way people really feel about whether the economy's doing well and whether incomes are up or not, and they continue to get slammed with student loans or whatever it is and healthcare costs that nobody's talking about. They're not buying a car and they're not buying a house.
Mm-hmm. I had that as one of the things on talking about that. Now, when you do a loan, are you... You know, you have to put your monthly payments as if you bought a car. Do you have to put down your health care costs as an expense?
No.
No. And see, that's a bite on affordability that's under the radar, is that you do all of a sudden have to consider, well, I can't afford that because I have this. And that's a growing concern. When Doug, you had invited me back and a few other investors, Sean was with us, and... talking about financing for investors. This was a long time ago. And we did absolutely no good as far as getting anybody to say, yeah, we'll go from 10 loans to 50 loans because Bruce is here or Sean's here or Tom's here.
We tried.
Yeah. And that was great. But who stepped in was the private sector. Right. So now there's billions of dollars chasing investors who have rentals or flips. And that's been a healthy thing. The interest rates have gone down for everybody. My question is, and we were back on a panel, and there was a room full of hedge funds that had raised $1 billion, and they all wanted to send it to the next group of rentals. And they're not going to find that at this point. So is there an appetite, do you think, for private funds to enter into the occupant sector of financing to where the rules may be different, and they could create programs where there are pieces missing that they could really do well? Is that possible? I don't know enough about finance to know if that vehicle is allowed even with the new rules.
Owner occupancy,
where you have, let's say, stated income loans that are for self-employed people, things like that, that we just can't seem to fund in the current environment. So
I think it is happening.
Okay.
I mean, but a lot of it's happening in the jumbo space, where the rules are somewhat different.
Okay.
Whether that happens in the conforming space, we'll see. That would be the non-QM. A lot
right.
of that you're probably talking about is a non-QM space. It depends on if the returns are sufficient for somebody to take the risk of legal action. I mean, I would argue one of the reasons that you don't see the extension of credit to the degree that you would like is there's a lot of institutions that have paid a lot of hundreds of millions of dollars in penalties,
well,
which will tell you when you go back to your shareholders, maybe we won't go all the way to the stated boundaries of the credit box, right?
Yeah.
We'll leave a little cushion. And I think that's clearly what's happening today.
Well,
so whether the private equity world enters that space, I wouldn't expect it on a large scale basis. And the private label market is not going to come back yet because there still has not been established a solid set of standards. So that people can understand the collateral and the risks related to that collateral. I do want to support Dave's comment on consumers, though, because our headline question in our survey is, is the economy on the right track or the wrong track? There's only been 1 month since June of 2010 in which the majority of people thought the economy is on the right track.
Okay.
So the public is broadly... doesn't believe the recession.
When I look at charts of promises that we've made, we have upcoming a chart that could go vertical if we don't have more revenue or we break promises. And so real estate is one of those investments that we really have a lot of goodies. There's no place else in the world where you can make $500,000 every 2 years tax-free. 1031 exchange, millions of dollars of assets, never pay taxes until it gets to be your estate and then turns to zero. So my question is, you know, we have all these goodies, including Prop 13. There's got to be an appetite to take a look at that box and say, can we have some of those goodies? Which ones probably are too sacred to touch, and which ones do you think could go by the wayside?
I can maybe take that. In California, I think the low-hanging fruit, at least this is the perception of the public employee unions who have an endless appetite for money, is that split roll property tax, where you tax commercial properties at a different level than residential. They're very much, very serious about potentially pursuing a November 2016 ballot measure that would enact a split roll, thereby bifurcating residential and commercial under Prop 13.
And that goes up in front of the vote of the people when?
Well, no, it's not
I'm
yet.
I'm only kidding. There, I know it
well,
doesn't.
But it could. I mean, we've been successful. One of the other hats I wear is I sit on the board of the California Business Properties Association, which are commercial industrial developers and real estate owners. And it's been something we've feared for years, but it's getting more. The drums are beating louder on the folks with the appetite for state money. And we do believe that, I mean, we've seen bills in the legislature that would amend the Constitution, amend Prop 13 to do this, but they can't be successful there because in the state legislature, you need a two-thirds vote in both houses of the legislature to pass a constitutional amendment and then put it on the ballot. So instead, we expect that if they're going to do it at all, they'll do it by initiative.
Okay. What about anything about 1031 exchanges? Is that anybody familiar with that? I think they were talking about limiting it to $1 million a year. I don't know who is, but again, that's just be aware that, you know, real estate has some goodies that could provide revenue, and some of it, you know, you could make a case for that. Yeah, that's pretty reasonable to have that discounted somewhat.
Well, it's interesting on the split roll, because if that really did happen, it'd probably be very beneficial to the residential market that's really been carrying the water, the commercial side, forever, because we don't have a split roll. And certainly my association, CAR, has always been opposed to a split roll. But it's kind of interesting if you just look at, you know, what... you know, what's happening there. I think the residential market would probably benefit.
How would it benefit? Because the taxes wouldn't change.
Well, I think one of
residential.
The things that's happening in the commercial is there's a lot of transfers that happen that don't get reassessed, right, because they're using stock.
Okay.
Isn't that right? So okay. It's kind of skirting
issue.
Is that part of the
That's been the argument
part
in
the
Capitol, but it hasn't
yeah.
It hasn't won the day. I mean, I can't remember off the top of my head the statistics on that,
yeah.
But a lot of that is a fallacy that the California Taxpayers Association, the folks who want to tax, have continued to profligate, and it seems to be catching. But that part of the industry that I'm involved with does not think that residential has been getting a free ride based on the backs of commercial, I'm sorry, vice versa.
Right,
the commercial
right.
Has been
and we had a task force that looked at it in great detail last year and came to the conclusion that we need to continue to support the current situation.
Okay.
What about the MID?
The realtors always go after that. My former employer. And when they
so,
talk about flat tax and all, I mean, that's
right.
It's like.
And that's always the argument.
Stand up and get
I'd
it.
Certainly, anybody in the room, be willing to give up your mortgage interest deduction for a flat tax at 24% all
yes.
Day long. Right? So it is a tax code problem. I mean, you're talking about 1031, it changes the MID, whatever it is. It's still an overall tax code structure problem.
Right.
That could release all this cash back into the market. I'd give it up tomorrow. I mean, I've never qualified a borrower in all the applications I've taken over the years and sat down and said, first-time home buyers especially, who don't itemize anyway, well, you know your mortgage interest deduction is going to be, and it's going to lower your payment a little bit, and you can qualify for an extra $10,000. Nobody does that. Okay? It's the people, the high end, don't use it and don't need it. The low end, don't deduct for it, and it's that meat in the middle. It doesn't really make any difference. So that is something that should be thrown out there if you can get a lower tax rate or tax rate.
Okay, so we have some tradable... Now, Leslie, you haven't said a word here.
Well, I mean, with tax reform, I mean, everything's on the table. And I think for 4 or 5 years, we've had a resolution going around Capitol Hill, and most of the California congressional delegation has signed it and essentially says, we support the MID, don't change it. But if anybody here remembers 1986, and it's like 11:30 at night, and all of a sudden these deals are cut, and voila, we have the $1 million cap on a residential mortgage for interest deduction. So I think anything's possible, but I do think, your points are well taken, and anecdotally, I'm sure they're true, but just doing the math, I mean, there is going to be losers when you get rid of the mortgage interest deduction. So how that trades off is interesting. I mean, some of the proposals that came out during the last presidential election weren't really targeted at MID, but they said we're going to cap all deductions at $50,000, $40,000, $30,000, whatever it might be. So it would be kind of an indirect take at that. So anything's possible, but it doesn't look like anything will happen until after the presidential election.
I think the bigger question is, what are your policy objectives for housing?
Right.
What are you trying to accomplish? So if what you're trying to accomplish is first-time home ownership, the mortgage interest deduction is a useless tool because the people at that income level don't itemize, so they don't deduct that. A first-time tax credit would actually be an incentive because it comes right off the amount of taxes that you paid. Of course, it wouldn't have the power that you think it would because people at that level don't actually pay that much taxes. About 96% of all the taxes are paid by people at the 50 percentile and above, so it's not as great a lever. Well, if you eliminated, I actually think if they're going to attack it, the first thing that will be done is the interest deduction on home equity loans will be eliminated, which is it's the interest on a maximum of $100,000.
Right.
I think that would be the first thing that would go. And then you may see an attempt to cap it at below $1 million, maybe at $500,000 or something like that. But what will happen if you eliminate it completely is because of what Dave said, it being a tool to get upper middle and upper middle income households to increase leverage and buy a bigger home, what will happen is people will consume less housing. Those house prices at the higher levels, not the very high level, because that's just a management issue, but at the upper middle income, those prices will fall, but prices at the low end will rise as people shift their consumption of housing down to smaller housing components.
Okay.
So there will be a redistribution of equity wealth in the housing market.
The concept of gentrification. Where is it occurring? Sean, you and I had talked briefly about this.
Certainly in Silicon Valley right now.
So for people that don't know what it is, which honestly I was one of them for, I had to look it up because it isn't happening in Riverside yet. But so, so what is it and who's being displaced and who are they being replaced by?
Well, you know, in Silicon Valley, you've got, I mean, it's the world's greatest draw for tech talent. You're bringing in, you know, the smartest people from around the world, and they're coming in to compete for those homes, and they're pushing the prices of those homes up. And that's displacing, you know, folks that have lived there for generations. Their kids can't buy a home there. They have to go somewhere else. And, you know, it's also pushing up rents, and they can't afford to rent there. And, you know, so that is happening. I mean, it's...
Is that free market, though?
It's absolutely free market. I'm not judgment.
No, I know you're not. I'm trying to put
it
out there not as a judgment thing. I'm saying, I guess I'm just making the point. That's free market. That's not a manipulation of holding interest rates down or minimum wage or whatever it is. It's the market working there, right?
Right.
Which is, I think, what we all want. So, I mean, it's bad for some, good for others, but... And then all of a sudden you want to come in and say, well, we can't have that, so we got to stop it. Why do you have to stop it?
Well, I think one of the issues is just workforce housing. And when, you know, firemen and policemen and teachers can't live near where they're working, it's not really very efficient. And that you can't have communities that accommodate diversity. You know, if only rich white people can live there, it's probably not going to be a very robust society. And for anyone that hasn't seen it yet, HBO has a very interesting documentary called San Francisco 2.0 that looks specifically at kind of the IT migration into San Francisco and what it's doing. And you're absolutely right. That's how market works. I mean, you've had gentrification. You know, I have a daughter in Brooklyn. I mean, you look at Brooklyn today, Brooklyn 20 years ago. I mean, it's a wonderful thing, but people are displaced, and there's a lot of pain, and it's just tough. You know, transitions are always tough. But I go back to the argument that workforce housing is absolutely critical for the health of a community, which is why if you don't have programs to kind of help with that adjustment, you just get people leaving and moving other places. And
can I play moderator for a second?
You bet. Go right
okay,
ahead.
So here's the question. So HUD right now is talking about, they're doing it, holding funds back to communities unless you build certain types of housing within certain types of neighborhood. You can, they want rental housing and lower income housing with high, and they're trying to create neighborhoods. And if you don't do that, you're not gonna get any funding. Is that?
And the only way you can force that is to put it on the back of a new home builder, if you have a new home builder in
right,
your neighborhood.
Right, but I'm saying, I'm throwing it out as a question, and I'm not judging it in any way at all. I'm just saying, but that's not a free market, and that is the government taking our money and saying you can't have it unless you do it our way. Okay, that's
I think part of the question here, if we want housing to be more affordable, let's build more affordable housing, not put on, you know, net zero energy. I mean, I love the idea of net zero energy home. I wish my home was net zero energy, but if we're going to add that $50,000 of cost to every affordable home that gets built, and this is the what's so nuts about the conversation. It's like, if we, these are solvable problems, right? We're really good with technology and other things, and if we get these to be non-political problems and start figuring out, okay, how do you build something that's more affordable? Well, you know, start by, you know,
less regulation.
I built a home, and you know, the amount of, I was telling somebody earlier, you know, I'm up in Tahoe. I have to support a 100-year snow load and a 100-year earthquake at the same time. The cost of building that level of infrastructure is enormous compared to what's been standing for 100 years downtown. It just seems so common sense to me. If you want to build affordable housing, you know, we can make homes less affordable. A friend of mine moved from California to Washington. Rains more in Washington. Well, guess what? In California, you have to put bitumen and do all these things around a window, right, to put a window in. Up there, you just nail a window in, and if it leaks, you get some caulk. It's not that hard.
Right.
Is there a connection for urbanization and gentrification? Anybody? And urbanization, what is that term? What does that term mean? We're going to live in like big cities. Now, you
well,
and I had
you
had
and
this
I
discussion.
Talked about
yeah.
this, and I can tell that Bruce is a kind of a gated community kind of guy. Am I right? And I'm a walkability kind of girl.
Now my,
you know,
my
I
son
like
is
living
that.
In a diverse environment where I can walk places, where I come into contact with people from all different everything that I'm not. And a lot of the millennials are like that. Now, I don't know if that will change when they have kids. And I did the gated community thing for 15 years, so I've been there, you know, and done that. But I think there's a whole new world out there of people that are looking at the trade-off between drive time and quality of life and saying, I'd really like to live near where I work, and I that trade-off is worth it. I think the other thing to think about, and there was a wonderful presentation at the LAEDC forecast for any of you that missed it from PricewaterhouseCoopers, who has this a lot of resources around this issue of your footprint. So in terms of resources that you're consuming, and one of the numbers that really stuck with me, the dates, was July 14th. And July 14th is the date at which everything that we have consumed can be replenished. And then after July 14th, we are using resources that, you know, we're in a deficit. And if you're in a smaller house, you know, 1,000 square feet, you're using a lot fewer resources than you are if you're in a 4,000 square foot home. And we're seeing that in the office market with these companies where everybody's got a stand-up desk in the middle and conference rooms around. So I think this whole idea of how much space you need and how much time you're actually spending out of your home, I mean, it's just a very different aesthetic. So I think the wonderful thing about living where we live is you can do it all, but it's happening, right? Because they're valuing their time above that kind of a lifestyle, and they kind of like the energy of being in a higher density environment. And for anyone that hasn't like trekked to downtown LA lately, I mean, it's amazing what's going on there. Finally, you know, it's very exciting and vibrant. So,
and isn't that is that a free market dictating how
that
I don't
think there are
built?
Any free markets anywhere.
I
just
agree
my
with
personal
that.
Thing. So I don't mean to disagree with you. You know, if the benefits go, what you know, I
that's
don't think
my
we
point,
have.
Leslie.
No, but I don't think there ever are, but
isn't it the market?
I
if
think
that's
there's
what
been a lot of subsidies.
If millennials are looking for that, then the market's going to dictate that that's what the builders are going to build.
Well, you know, downtown LA is essentially what you're seeing is urban reuse, you know, where they're taking these old bank buildings and old office buildings and making them into condominiums. I mean, there's just a lot of really creative, wonderful things going on that don't really have anything to do with government or whatever. It just made sense for the developer to do that because the demand was there and you had these urban pioneers. And I think it's right. It's very exciting.
I think there is one development that gives more credibility to that than one might have looking sort of over history, and that's the development of charter schools. The fact that now part of the flight to the suburbs was to get access to good quality schools, because a lot of the urban schools in many urban districts, not all, but in many, are not very healthy schools. So to the extent that the millennials would like a closer urban setting and they have access to charter schools, that I think has been some development. But if you match what they say as an aspiration to their actions, of those who have formed renting households, the majority are renting single family homes. And that's what they're actually doing if you look at the American Community Survey. And so there's a statistical thing that you have to be careful of when you're looking at any group. If you go back 10 years, there were lots of predictions that the boomers liked to party. So when the kids moved out, they were gonna sell their suburban homes and get a condo downtown and party the night away. Now my wife and I live in Cape Coral, Florida, which our kids call God's waiting room. And I have to tell you, if you're going to get a reservation at a good restaurant in Cape Coral, wait till about 7:30. So what people saw was there were some boomers that were selling their suburban home and moving to the city, but there are so many of them that the number that were out in that behavioral tail was larger than their parents' population group. And so numerically you saw it happening, but proportionally there was not a behavioral change. So I think the same thing's going to apply to some degree with the millennials, because they are a larger population group than the boomers. So yes, some of them will do that. We don't know for sure whether it's going to be a behavioral change, but I think you kind of need to watch that characteristic. The fact that a number of them do it, that's important, but it may not reflect a behavioral change.
I just want to add one other thing with respect to affordability and baby boomers, and that is I think one of the key distinguishing characteristics of this cycle, at least from the perspective of my group, is lack of inventory. And I think that has to do with baby boomers who might want to sell and party downtown, but they're stuck. They can't afford to do it, right? Because even though their home has increased in value a lot, what they want to do is even more expensive. Plus, they might be giving up a great low-rate mortgage because, you know, they might That's be right. giving up a great tax base, particularly with Prop 13 in California. They have capital gains to worry about. They may not be able to qualify for a mortgage, the one they got 10 years ago, they're not going to be. So there's all kinds of reasons that have made listing inventory so sticky, you know, and I think people are stuck. And one of the portals did a survey of people asking, you know, how satisfied are you with your home? And you know what? Everybody loves being a homeowner, but, you know, they want to tweak it. You know, they'd like to move, but they simply can't afford to do it. And I think that might be a structural impediment that's going to be with us for quite a while.
A futuristic question. I like going in limos with the group because I usually hear something. And 1 year, Sean was in there talking about 3D printers, and I honestly had never even heard of one. And he said he was buying his 10-year-old son one. I was like, okay. So I go home.
He printed the limo you were driving in, actually.
I go home and I pull it up, and then I sort of pay attention to it, and all of a sudden they're building a house with a 3D printer somewhere. So, you know, when I see that, is there any future in that becoming a competitor? You know, we get these little house shows where they've got this 80 square foot house. I mean, how long would it take a 3D printer to whoop one of those up?
We are so overdue for technical innovation in the building industry that, you know, so if you look back at that, you know, Robert Shiller's chart that everybody was looking at kind of before the thing burst, there was a period back in the 20s where prices dropped quite a bit, and it wasn't due to economic or to, you know, loans or those types of things. It was due to the fact that gypsum board and stick frame construction became popular, and the cost of building a house went down dramatically. And I actually think that's one of the more interesting things. I don't think it's next year. I don't think it's within the next 5 years. But I could foresee a time when it's costs half of what it builds, costs today to build a house, maybe less. If you look at the stuff they're doing in China and other places where they're literally, they've got robots welding bridges, right? And the robots are riding on rails that the robots themselves printed to print a bridge, right? And so they literally follow themselves out over this thing and connect it on the other side.
No one's ever gone on it after that. But I'm only kidding.
But the ability to do a lot of that stuff's a lot closer than we think. And again, this particular building standards, the building code today doesn't envision all of those any of those things. And it talks about certain clips that have to be used and other things that are totally, the opposite of that, progress. So how those two things collide and what jurisdictions that care about affordability will allow some of these experiments to happen that are well-engineered, structural, no issues, probably have better structural
energy
characteristics than current house building techniques, but it's not going to follow the current code. So you're going to have somebody willing to break those molds.
The first time I looked up a 3D printer, I happened on an article where there was a baby born with a heart defect, and they took a 3D scan, made a copy of the kid's heart from a 3D printer. The doctor got to hold the kid's heart outside of his body, but it was just a replica. They saw where the defect was, and then they did the surgery right where it needed to be. I mean, holy mackerel.
Wow.
That's amazing. That's what a 3D printer can do. So. And then, and then they're building houses. So anyway, I just thought, wow, that's pretty amazing.
My son's been working on a project. There's a company, and I'm going to forget the name of it, but you can look it up, where you can contribute. It's an open source for building prosthetics. And you can contribute either by helping out with designing new prosthetics, or if you have a printer at home, you can print a whole prosthetic arm, hand, whatever, for somebody. And, as a donation. Wow. You know, so it's really interesting.
That is.
Oddly, I think that the building industry is kind of screaming for something because we are having a heck of a time finding workers who will build what we need to do to keep up with what little, you know, demand we're able to fill just because of all the regulation. Our workers left during their session and they haven't come back. They went and found other things to do. So we're kind of screaming for the need for, you know, a way to do development with fewer people. But I think that whole regulatory overlay, not only at, I mean, the state level, but also the local level, I mean, this is one of the most overregulated industries we have, and this is the only hook they've got is when you're building a new home. So they are going to do everything they can to make it as you know, traditional as they see fit at the regulatory level, and I don't think anybody at the regulatory level is thinking outside the box that we want to go to 3D printers and make a house less affordable. I mean, more affordable, I'm sorry. Less, you know what I mean. I don't think anybody's saying, well, let's find a way to make housing cheaper, so we'll go this route instead of, you know, requiring this joist and that bolt instead of the ones we're doing today. I just not, I mean, we're draconian in our regulation, and we keep ratcheting down on what we got without thinking outside the box.
It's not all on the regulators, too, though. I mean, if you walked into an architect and said, you know, look, this is what I want to do, they wouldn't have the capability. Structural engineers don't have the capability. Right. They just don't have that training and background.
Right.
So, I mean, it's a education, you know, all of that's got to change, but I think it will.
How much of the increase in cost of housing has come from the building itself versus the land and the development costs and the availability of land, I think, is a kind of a question.
Much, yeah, no, it is definitely the cost of land in California.
Yeah.
It's huge.
But, you know, what's nuts, really, bigger than anything else, is the fact that we don't know that answer, right? Mm-hmm. So you look at the major markets, stocks, bonds, commodities, real estate, money markets, right? And it's only real estate, no offense, Leslie, where we self-report 30 days after the fact on what the heck happened, right? Everything else we know down to the second how many trades happened and what they were for and all the rest.
Right.
I mean, this industry is a joke when it comes to instrumenting what's happening on a day-to-day basis.
Well, it's undocumented, you know? I mean, people call me all the time and ask me very reasonable questions like, what is the share of Chinese buyers in the California housing market in 2014, and I'm like, well, I don't know, but we did a survey, and this is what our survey of our members said. But on the other hand, there's privacy issues. I mean, nobody kind of fills out a form and sends it to Sacramento or sends it to the California Association of Realtors when they buy a piece of property and tells us all this great information that ought to be available. I mean, it's really a problem. I could not agree with you more.
I thought one thing that for sure would come out of the downturn would be, you know, that somebody would say, geez, we got to fix this recording system so that we can see this coming next time, right? And, you know, it'd be a very cheap solution to go fix the 3,150 county recorders, have all documents filed electronically, have all of that data available the minute that it was filed, add some additional questions if there's some additional important questions like, are you a citizen? Are you, you know, whatever? Are you a foreign national buying? You know, things that we might want to have some understanding of what's impacting prices in Silicon Valley. Is it just tech workers coming in, or is it folks from, you know, somebody's talking about the Chinese coming in and leaving homes, buying $1.5 million homes and leaving them vacant because they just want the appreciation and it's too much work to deal with a renter?
Right.
We don't know. We have no idea.
So those HMDA questions are now going to be forced on lenders, to your point. Lenders are worried what happens after October 3rd. TRID happened, right? Just happened, which is supposed to.
Is that a four-letter word?
It is a four-letter word. And the CFPB really hates it. I don't think you'll find it on their website, right? What is that? TILA, RESPA, Integra, TILA? TILA,
Truth
TILA?
Truth and Lending.
Right, TILA, TILA.
Are you opposed to that, Truth and Lending?
Am I opposed to truth? Oh, come on. I'll meet you in the bar with pistols at 50 paces.
Free markets.
Free market. It's TILA, RESPA, Integrated Disclosures. Thank you. But what's coming in the next 2 years, they've given everybody 2 years, they have to start collecting all this additional HMDA data, right? They don't know exactly what it is, and they have privacy issues, to your point. Now, I'm not really here tonight. I'm not sitting up here, but I will tell you, all that data is being collected, and something that we have, as far as recording goes, at First American, something, a new product we just came out with called Data Tree, or Data Tree, depending on how you pronounce it. And we've got about 89%. We've got about 89% of the counties covered right now, right? And so that information is close, and you'll have that at your fingertips pretty soon. So it's coming.
Okay.
But hum the data is the fear of lenders after TRID. And nobody knows, and I mean, we haven't really touched on TRID tonight, but that's really what's affecting my end of it from an origination standpoint right now is we have no idea how it's affecting. It's only been in, what, force for 10 days? We have to disclose now to the borrower not only their good faith estimate, but we have to give them their total cost before they go to closing, 3 days before they go to closing. When has that ever happened?
Well, I think that was the point.
Right. You know, for the cost of... So,
but here's the whole thing. We survived for years doing it just great. We had this one little three-year window where it wasn't so good. Right? We're making better loans today than we've made in 20 years, and they keep adding on onerous regulations and driving up the cost. And if you think the consumer's not paying for it, then you're not awake.
You know,
the consumer's paying for it.
For the cost of implementing HMDA, you know, for HMDA through all the lenders, we could have fixed the recording, you know, system. Seriously, and that would have been way better for everyone.
All right, we're really out of time. I want to just go, we'll go from Doug first. Answer one of these two questions, okay?
Ooh. I'm from Washington. If somebody asks you a question you don't like, you answer a different one.
I'm going to, well, now you have a choice up front. Isn't that good? Okay. What one positive change would you like to see in 2016, or what outside of real estate causes you concern that could impact housing in an indirect way?
Well, the Fed will have both direct and indirect impact, so I am concerned about the Fed's posture in the market. I think they're way late in the game, and they're distorting asset prices, so I think that's a big issue.
Okay. Leivas?
At CBIA, we are going to change something in 2016, and that is the way schools, well, we aren't going to change the way school facilities are financed. We're going to continue the existing process as a, you know, self-aggrandizing commercial right now. If we run out of money at the state level for new school facilities to be built, then all bets are off under existing law, and builders and developers must pay 100% of the cost of new school construction. So no more state money, no more school district match, only on the builder-developer. So we have we've circulated petitions to qualify a school bond for the November 2016 ballot, and that will maintain the three-way sharing of state-local builder match for funding new school facilities out well into the future. And so that's the way, that is the positive change we are going to affect for our industry, so that fees for schools alone don't go up $20,000-$30,000 per home.
Okay.
Les? You know, what keeps me up at night is really related to schools, and that is just the educational attainment, quality, skill level of our kids and our future, and our inability to, you know, compete globally. I think a lot of the things we've talked about in terms of housing affordability and all that kind of comes down to income growth, right? And jobs and skills and being able to, you know, get on a career path that's very positive. And I think for a whole series of reasons that's been kind of compromised, and we really are lagging behind, particularly in engineering, science, and math, which are the cornerstone of this new economy, you know, with design and so on and so forth. So I think that's something that we really have to get back to. And it's probably on a household by household basis, but that does concern me a lot.
David? I don't even remember what the questions were. But
here's, well, because you're not here, that's what happened.
Why start now? Here's what I really would like to see.
Okay.
The people that make the rules for all of us understand what the hell they're making, all right? And that it, they have to realize how it affects it because they never have to live by them. There's no accountability right now, truthfully. It's the way it's set up by Dodd-Frank. CFPB has no accountability. It reports to the Department of the Treasury, which reports to the president. They're unchecked. And they've done a pretty good job in some areas. In some areas, it's been really, really difficult. MBA, NAR, the home builders have done an amazing job as an advocacy group working with the CFPB and reining in some of these onerous regulations, but I just would love to see the people in Washington, D.C., big wish, all right, understand and listen to the people that they're making the rules on top of. They don't do that, and okay. They never have to live by them. That would be my wish.
Thank you. Sean?
Top that.
Do you need a...
I have no idea what the questions were at this point. I was paying attention to everybody. You know, I think my biggest hope for next year is that, you know, we can start to have a serious debate among presidential candidates around, you know, some of these important issues. You know, I think the hitting the... This is a zero bound on interest rates and not being able to grow our economy through debt. I think the fact is technology makes us need fewer people working, that labor participation rate. And we are, in my humble opinion, 40 years into technology, but we are about here on a curve that's about to do this. And, you know, you've got McDonald's now that are fully automated and don't need a single worker. You know, so... I think there's a lot more of that coming, and to not have a single conversation about anything that matters in these debates kills me.
Yeah.
And that's would be my wish for 2016, that somewhere along there we start talking about things that actually really matter.
And to wrap up, and it's sort of the same line, I wish that every elected official wouldn't be a Republican next year, wouldn't be a Democrat, they'd be an American and do what's best for the people of the country. With that, we have nailed it almost exactly at 10 o'clock. We want to thank you all for being here tonight and participating, and we hope you found it a very enjoyable evening. Thanks so much for coming.